everyone to our latest presentation on tocilizumab in patients with COVID-19. This presentation is basically to make sense of all the data that has been published till now. Interleukin-6 is a cytokine that has diverse and pivotal roles in the inflammatory and immune response to infection. And it's also an important downstream regulator of the coagulation cascade. Dysregulation of the IL-6 signaling pathways have been linked to inflammatory mediated conditions such as rheumatoid arthritis, juvenile idiopathic arthritis, and the cytokine release storm that is sometimes associated with chimeric antigen receptor T-cell therapy. Tocilizumab and sarilumab are monoclonal antibodies that target the IL-6 receptor and are approved by the authorities for use in these conditions. The pathogenesis of COVID-19 associated infections is because of the profound coagulation abnormalities and the accentuated inflammatory response. Several observational cohort studies and RCTs have reported the use of tocilizumab and sarilumab in patients with COVID-19 related respiratory failure. Now let's see what are the studies which have been done and what are the findings. Up till March 5th, 2021, we identified around 10 RCTs of tocilizumab and sarilumab, including 7,050 patients which have been completed and reported. Out of this, 9 have been published in peer-reviewed papers and 1 is available as a preprint. Tocilizumab was generally administered at a dose of 8 mg per kg intravenously, with at least half of the studies allowing a repeat dose within the first 24 hours. Sarilumab was administered IV at a dose ranging from 200 to 400 milligrams. Impacta, Remapcap, and recovery trials were the major RCTs showing benefit of tocilizumab in COVID-19 infection. None of the other 6 trials demonstrated benefit, and one trial had to be stopped early because of the signal of increased mortality in patients who had received tocilizumab. Now, because of this heterogeneity, we will try to see why there is so much diverse literature coming from the various RCTs. First, we will look into the clinical sources of the heterogeneity. The severity of the disease process. Although all RCTs included hospitalized patients who required supplemental oxygen, important variability exists in the initial severity of the disease used for inclusion and exclusion of the patients. Certain trials excluded patients who required invasive and non-invasive ventilation. The examples are given over here. While the Remapcap study included only those patients who had ICU admissions and used non-invasive and invasive ventilation. This was their inclusion criteria. Now, the severity of the disease is also an important factor in interpreting the results because of these two mechanisms. The first is the different degree of clinical severity might be associated with different magnitude of inflammation, with those at more severe end of the spectrum with the highest levels of inflammatory cascade activation expected to benefit most. Now, until and unless we find those patients, it will be unlikely that we will get any benefit of tocilizumab. The Remapcap study that demonstrated one of the largest estimates of benefit in tocilizumab included only those patients who were within 24 hours of requiring non-invasive oxygenation or invasive mechanical ventilation. The rest of the studies were not really that particular in terms of the severity of the disease which were included. There was a large difference and some even excluded the severest group, that is the patients on ventilator. The next is the timing of randomization. Clinician caring for the hospitalized patient with severe COVID-19 usually retrospectively look at 2 very important time intervals. The first is the onset of the symptoms. When did the patient first develop the symptoms? The second being the point of clinical deterioration. These two are some very important things which the clinician take into account while starting these sort of medications. Now, viral replication probably peaks early, and the peak of the inflammatory response sometimes coincides or slightly precedes the clinical deterioration. If the inflammatory cascade achieves the activity of hyperactivation, it might be too late to intervene, which means that if all the cytokines are already there, it is unlikely that we are going to get any benefit by just blocking the IL-6. It has therefore been hypothesized that there is a time window which exists. This time is the point between after the viremia and before the inflammatory markers have reached that level where they cannot be checked anymore. The REMAP-CAP trial used this 24-hour window, which we already said, from the point of clinical deterioration, which they indicated as the use of HFNC, NIV, or invasive mechanical ventilation. So they used this term for clinical deterioration. However, the recovery trial did not show an important interaction between the use of tocilizumab from the time of onset of symptoms, that is less than 7 days or more than 7 days. So we cannot really say that it is the timing from the onset of symptoms which is going to be important. Individual patient meta-analysis is therefore required to be useful in and to find the right timing of giving tocilizumab. The next is concomitant use of steroids. The use of co-intervention in all of these trials was highly variable. Probably owing to the difference in the time of the trial being conducted, that is before and after the recovery trials showing major benefit with steroids. Before that, many of the centers were not using steroids as a standard protocol. And also because of the local clinical practice, many places were using hydroxychloroquine, lopinavir, ritonavir as a standard care of therapy, which have been later proven to be of not much use. Recovery found an interaction between the use of steroids and tocilizumab. The subgroup showed the maximum benefit, but we are not sure. This is just a subgroup analysis. Whether both the drugs are required or not is still not something which has been established. Other differences in the standard care or usual care that varied across the trial and settings, including the use of other drugs, the method of delivery of the supportive therapy, might also contribute to the observed difference in treatment. Finally, the decision about the features of the standard arm might limit the applicability of the study findings in different settings. Since the standard arm was so grossly different between all the studies, it is different to actually say the study can be extrapolated to different settings. This is especially in the presence of effect modification and practice misalignment. Now, the baseline inflammatory status before the tocilizumab was started. These studies used the serological markers to enrich the study population, include patients with elevated inflammatory markers. However, among this, only recovery has shown benefit, while the tocibras has shown harm. This markers may not be appropriate for the initiation of therapy, C-reactive D-dimer and ferritin. So it is not that baseline inflammatory status is not going to affect the use of tocilizumab. It's just that probably these agents, that is CRP, D-dimer and ferritin, are not going to be a predictor of the response to tocilizumab. A systematic review and meta-analysis has found that the interleukin 6 level concentrations in critically ill patients was not significantly higher in patients with less severe disease. So this was the study, and in this they found that whether the patient had a severe disease or all patients, there was not much difference into between the level of interleukin 6. So IL-6 acts as a predictor or an effector or both for clinical deterioration is a fundamental question that needs to be answered. The current evidence is that it doesn't give any information. Among the RCTs that showed no difference with tocilizumab, patients randomized to receive tocilizumab had higher concentration of the cytokines, which means that they were not really a predictor that tocilizumab is going to work. Now look at the methodological sources of heterogeneity. The first is the observational studies. Most of the positive trials have been observational. Observational studies have included mostly patients with higher level of disease severity, who are thus expected to have more inflammatory state and potentially increase the statistical power of these tests to find a benefit. More importantly, because it's an observational study, there is always a selection bias and the clinician is more likely to include those patients who are already expected to survive. Notwithstanding this limitation, large studies have a very important role, especially in 3 points. In shedding light on the subgroup of patients who might benefit with IL-6 blockade, in providing crucial information on the side effects and secondary infections, and lastly is find effect of the therapy in immunocompromised and pregnant patients who are often excluded in RCTs. Now, absence of blinding. RCTs were mostly all open label trials, so there was no blinding in the studies. Blinded RCTs were unmasked because the changes in the inflammatory markers was quite obvious in the tocilizumab group. The internal validity of the trials is questionable because there is no blinding. Now, outcome selection and analytical strategies. There has been a wide variation in the primary outcome, ranging from mortality to clinical status to the 7-point ordinal scale of the WHO. Every parameter has been used. These inconsistencies might reflect difference in statistical power due to the chosen endpoint and the likelihood of tocilizumab to influence them. We are not sure whether tocilizumab will actually affect those endpoints. The use of Bayesian design in the REMCAP study is a major limitation because the priors which were used could be altered to get a positive final result. Challenges and future directions. These are the questions which need to be answered. We do not really have an answer as of now. These are the exploration of the timing of the tocilizumab administration and the enhanced patient selection, who to give and when to give. This is very important to know. We don't know the answer right now. This is especially required to maximize the benefit and reduce the harm. Patients with ongoing and active bacterial and fungal infections, what is the role of safety of IL-6 blockade in these settings? Surveillance for potential detrimental effects, such as increased risk of infection, is again something which needs to be looked for specifically in tocilizumab. The extent to which the benefits that we have seen in some trials with tocilizumab, which can be extrapolated to sarilumab, it is not yet sure. The last is the long-term effect. We are not sure whether the impact of tocilizumab will have on long-term outcomes of the patient. But this is very unlikely something is going to be a problem because this is, drug is given just a single dose for immediate benefit. So I don't think there should be any long-term impact of this particular medication. Cost effectiveness is definitely something which needs to be looked at, what benefit we are getting from the cost that is actually being given. Its utility in the pandemic situation remains very limited, especially because there have been conflicting reports and there is still not sure which population is going to benefit. The impact of preprint. A lot of these studies were preprint already published before they were peer reviewed and finally published in the impact of these preprint trials which are published without any peer review on the subsequent data that is being published cannot be ruled out. The impact that a positive study is more likely to get published. These are the studies which have been done, the major RCTs. This table includes all the major findings, that is the inclusion criteria, the number of patients, primary outcomes, the main results, and the comments. You can pause the video and see the studies, or you can check our website and the blog to know more details about these studies. So the take home for us is, should all severely ill patients with acute hypoxemic respiratory failure receive tocilizumab? This is the major question that is going to be answered. One answer fits all is extremely unlikely. We cannot say for sure with the evidence we have right now that this is answer to this question is a yes. But yes, the only thing that we can say is tocilizumab is probably beneficial among patients who require respiratory support soon after the time of clinical deterioration. In a pandemic situation, we cannot go for testing to find which patient is on cytokine storm, since most of these tests, as we have already said, the CRP, ferritin, even IL-6 levels are not at all a predictor of finding which patient is in cytokine storm and which patient should receive tocilizumab. So the final take is, tocilizumab should be given to patients who are on HFNC, NIV or invasive ventilation, and it should be given within 24 hours without any testing. This is the data and the statement based on the evidence that we have currently. Thank you for your patience, and check our website for further information.